VBA. Control shift enter or a macro way. Well, there's my G on the CSE. Billy J getting down with the VBA. Oh my, it's a Duel in Excel time. Stand by, it's a Duel in Excel time. La la, it's Duel in Excel time.
Hey, welcome back. It's time for another Dueling Excel podcast. I'm Bill Jelen from Mr. Excel. I'll be joined by Mike Gervin from Excel's Fund. This is our episode 168, Realtor Schedule Tool. All right, today's question via YouTube from John. He's a real estate agent. He's trying to figure out a computation of time spreadsheet. For example, we have a buyer that has an offer accepted. This begins a time frame, and within 10 days, the inspection has to be completed. And then there's other events that are dependent on either the inspection or the original offer acceptance date. And so how do you set this up? All right, I'm probably needlessly complicating this, but let's start over here with this events table that I created. So I've listed 9 different events here. I've used these codes A through I, but then I put a friendly description here, so that way, you know, when we print it, the buyer can understand what's going on. And so each item has, you know, a description. So the offer acceptance, and then like John said, 10 days after the offer acceptance, the inspection has to be done. So this is 10 days after item A. Once we have the inspection done, and I'm making stuff up here, the title search has to be done within 7 days after item B. But then things that the buyer is supposed to do, like you're supposed to get your financing approved, that has to happen 25 days, not after the inspection, but after the original offer acceptance. All right, so hey, you better go start getting financing immediately and don't wait for the inspection. So you see that each item here has a, let's call it a predecessor, and it's some number of days after that predecessor. And to further complicate things, because some of these things are based on banks, I am using business days instead of just straight days. Now that might add a complication that we don't really need, but so because I'm going to use business days, I have a list here of all of the holidays, the holiday table. So those two tables are off to the right hand side where no one's going to see them. And we come back here to build the actual item. So here's what I have. I have columns for the event code, the description, the date that I think that it should happen, and then we sometimes will fill in the actual date. All right. So you want to use the forecast date until we have an actual date. Actually, what I really want to do, when you get right down to it, I want to use the last date to occur in this tiny little row of two cells, right? I don't want to use the min, I don't want to use the max, I want to use the last date that I find, because that's the good date. And so here's the first Excel trick in this whole thing, is I'm using HLOOKUP into this tiny little range of two cells, looking up a date that is larger than any possible date into that range. I'm looking for the first row, and I'm doing a comma true, all right? So this comma true version of HLOOKUP is the weird one when it can't find a number that is smaller than this or larger than this, it just gives up and gives me the last number that it finds. All right, so it's giving me 1121. And by way of illustration, I want you to watch here. This is 12/8. If I change this to a different date, 12/6/14, all right, it updates to show me 12/6/14. Or if I change it to a later date, 12/10/14, it updates to show me the later date. So it's not a min or a max. It's just saying, hey, if you know whatever the last date in this tiny row of two cells is the date to use. All right, now for item A, there are no predecessors, so I just blacked those out so we don't fill them in. All right, and then we're going to come down here to the second event. And you see, this is just formulas that are pointing up here. Same thing, formulas that are pointing up here, and I copied those down. So as you change things in the table, they will change here as well. All right, now the forecast date is based on these calculations. So the predecessor, what's the predecessor for item B? We do a VLOOKUP for item B, come out here to the fourth column and say the predecessor is A. All right, so that's our first test. Then, what was the date for item A? So I look up item A into this red table back here. I'm looking for the fifth column, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the date to use, comma zero. I'm doing an exact match. That's the same as doing a comma false. And then the delay is based on this table up here, where I'm getting the third column again, an exact match. All right, so once I know that this item happens after item A, this is the best guess we have for item A, and this is the number of days. It's just a simple matter of adding 10 workdays to 1121. How do we get workdays? Use the workday function. So starting from age 17, we want to go out 10 workdays, and oh, by the way, these holidays don't count into the calculation. All right, so once I got row 2 done, just copied it down to all of the other rows, and it seems to work. All right, so here, the buyer has until December 8th to get an inspection done. Good news, the inspector came out, the buyer says go, and that happened on the 5th. Watch, a lot of these dates down here automatically change. Well, some of the dates change. The things that are still dependent on item A, they remain where they were. All right, so that's my very complicated way of doing this. Mike, I'm interested to see what approach you take.
Thanks, Mr. Excel. Oh, man, now I know why they call you Mr. Excel. There's just no way. How did you figure this all out from that question? Man, look what I did. I read this question and I thought they wanted a start date and number 10, and they just wanted a list of dates. So there's the formula. I copy it down. It just gives me a list of date. If I type 15, boom. Oh, man. But I guess now that I've reread this question 30 times and watched your video segment 5 times, I think I sort of get it. Now, let's just delete all this and see my way of doing it. It's not the same way as yours at all. Still not quite sure how you got so smart. But here, I'm just going to take the, I have a column here. Here's the category. Here's the previous, and here's the key. So all I did is I looked over to the previous, and I said, oh, I have to go get the date from before here. That's the offer date. And then I have to go up to this table, find B, and then get 10. And so that's what I did. And so I manually built, right? So this one says I got to go get the B date and then go up and get the C from this table, so I'm adding 7. Here, I have to look all the way back up to A and then go up and get D days, right? Man, so you could do that. I guess that would work, right? So it's a little bit of a hassle. And even when I did this by hand, I made all sorts of mistakes. So maybe we could try and figure out the logic, which is basically this. I'm always going to, when I'm in this row, I'm going to look up the B to get the date from above. So down here, or let's say right here, I need to look at that A, but then remember to go up to the top to get the A date. And then I'm going to do a second lookup that goes up here, finds this category from the key column, and gets the number. All right, so you ready? Equals VLOOKUP. We'll try VLOOKUP to look up the date above. So I'm going to look up, boom. That's going to be the previous, comma. The lookup table is going to be just like that, but I'm going to have to lock the first F4 because it's going to have to expand as I go down, comma, and I have to make sure I get this right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so the fifth column. And I'm not putting anything for lookup range because this is alphabetical. It is sorted, close parentheses, so I can accept the default, which is true. So that's not going to work, but that'll give me the date. All right, so, and if I copy this down, you couldn't see anything because it'd all be 1126. But now I'm going to plus and VLOOKUP the actual number of days I need to add. So I'm actually now looking up the actual key, comma. The table will be just to the third column. And I'm noticing it's sorted, F4 to lock it, comma 3. It's sorted, so I'm leaving it out, Control Enter. And double click and send it down. That definitely does not do what Mr. Excel does, which is take into consideration that you might actually have an early date. But it does create this list of dates from this information up here. Now, if we needed to do it with weekday, we'd start off with the workday. And I'm going to do the international. That's 2010 or later. The start date. Well, for right now, I'm just going to click there. I'll come back and fix it in a second. And the days, well, I know it's to A, so I got to go get, I mean, for the B, I have to get the 10, comma. I'm going to assume it's whatever. I'm going to say 1, which is the default, but we'll put 1 in. And then the holidays. F4, close parentheses. So I'm going to notice that maybe I could put a VLOOKUP there to get the date from above, and then VLOOKUP there to go and get that. So watch this. I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to cheat. This is because I can't type very well. I'm in edit mode, right? I'm actually going to change the formula for a second, because now when I paste this over here, it wouldn't work, because I need to look at the workday column. And I'm going to change it to 6. And I'm going to highlight, Control CC to open up the clipboard. And then I'm going to highlight this. It'll work just fine. Control C. Now I've loaded up the clipboard. Escape. By escaping, I get back. I didn't, you know, keep that 6 in the expanded range. Now I'm going to come over here, double click the start date. And I can't see, but I think that was this one right here. And then double click the number of days. And that better be the one that's looking up here. And sure enough, it is. All right, I got my fingers crossed. Control Enter, double click, and send it down. Wow, that is insane, Mr. Excel. How did you figure all this out? Have you done real estate or something like that? All right, throw it back to Mr. Excel.
Hey, all right, Mike. There were a lot of cool tips in there. I love how you can just open that clipboard pane with the shortcut key. That's really, really cool. But you know, I need to clarify one thing that you said. You right around the 810 mark in our combined video, how you were finishing up that VLOOKUP, and you said, hey, I'm not putting anything for the fourth argument, the lookup range argument, because this lookup table is sorted. Now, when you don't put anything, that's not saying that we don't care if it's false or true. It's explicitly saying that you're doing the true, and you're right, you're generally okay with the data being sorted, but you're also assuming that there's never going to be a miss. And in this case, yeah, A through H, they're all there. But you know, what if someone accidentally typed, you know, the wrong letter? They meant to type a D and they hit an S. Well, now it's going to give you an answer as if it found something, when in fact it didn't. So just want to clarify that, you know, the rule for choosing true or false, there's good reasons for choosing true. But it's not just because the table's sorted. It has to be sorted, and you know that you're never going to have a miss or anything like that. So I've been talking about VLOOKUP trues a lot in my Power Excel seminar. And so just, you know, I wanted to clarify that. But hey, thanks. It's great to be dueling podcasts again. I've been on the road. Right now I'm down in Florida for the Orion rocket launch as part of the NASA social media program. So I'm out having fun. And so this took a while, primarily because of me. I want to thank everyone for stopping by. We'll see you next time for another Dueling Excel podcast. From Mr. Excel, Excel is fun.